Welcome. Want to welcome our visitors this morning. We're glad that you're here with us this morning. Just a few quick announcements. First off, after church, after the fellowship time, about 12:20, 12:30, we're going to have a chain of lights meeting. That's a community event that Sutton puts on that we're going to partake in. So we're just going to sit down and discuss that, of our plans and everything. Next Tuesday, there's no growth group. Pastor Don was asked to work some OT at his job. So unfortunately, there's no growth group Tuesday, but we'll resume the following week. Our next Vision Sunday is the 29th. So we're excited. Every fifth Sunday of the months that have a fifth Sunday, we have Vision Sunday to go over what our vision is for the church and just discuss that. And next Saturday, August 11th, Case for Christ here at the church. Bring family, Ruby, invite family, invite friends. From 6 to 8, popcorn and drinks will be provided, so come on out and enjoy that. Our women's ministry and men's ministry will resume in the fall. So plans are in works for that. We're going to change the time for the women's event from 1 to 3 to 9 to 11. And we're also going to start a brand new book series for the women. So we're really excited about that. So let's continue on in worship this morning.
All right. Good morning, church. Before we get into our sermon, a few things. First, we got a little announcement, and then we're going to pray and dismissal. But, been a year since I've been here, and I know when I was doing the interview process, I had talked about the North American Missions Board and their dedication to revitalizing and replant churches. So, this week I was notified, if you notice, we got almost all of New England here. And you'll see that there's two dots. Those two dots are the first two recognized replants for the North American Missions Board. The first one, you know, First Church in Charlestown. They were here last weekend helping us paint downstairs. They've been here a couple of times helping us out. Pastor Malloy has been a good help, good friend. So they're one of the first two. And then the second one, you might recognize the name. So we are officially a replant. What that means, and I can give you more information after church, but the North American Missions Board is trying to get money to help replants and churches in need of revitalization in areas that they need. And there's a number of churches that have tithed their own tithes and offerings. They put 10% aside to help those. So in August 27th and 28th, Pastor Boy and myself are going to be flying down to Alpharetta, to the NAM headquarters. BCND is sending us. That way there we can learn the process, learn what we need to do and how to get in touch with those churches. So this is a big thing for us. And this is also a big answer to prayer for many of us. So God is there, I swear we're going to need to have like a chart somewhere where we can just check off all the answered prayers over the last year that we've had. But this is the big thing. So let me pray. Talking about prayer. Now, Natalie forgot this, but visitors, if you would, we have these little welcome cards. Fill out as much information as you're comfortable giving us, and we'd like to get in contact with you and find out a little more about you, find out, ask you some questions about the service and other things. With that, I'm going to go to the Lord in prayer, and then I will dismiss the kids to kids' camp. Father in heaven, we come before you now, and we thank you for this day. We thank you that you are our God that answers prayers. We thank you that we can gather here freely to worship you today, to learn more about you. And Father, right now we lift up those churches in other parts of the country, in parts of the country where they're struggling, where they're going through their own issues, Father. We pray that they would turn their eyes to you, that they would remember that you are a God that delivers and a God that strengthens and a God that just is a refuge and strength. And Father, we pray for our brothers and sisters throughout the world that meet in secret. We pray that your hand of protection be upon them. We pray that you would just show them your love and mercy and just protect them as they strive to learn more about you. And Father, we just pray for the service today. We pray that you would open our hearts and minds to what is going to be said. And we pray that you would just pour your spirit out here in the presence of us. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, kids, you are dismissed to kids' camp. So today we are going to be in Psalm 119, and we're not going to study the whole psalm. We're continuing our series, Summer in the Psalms. We're not going to go through the whole psalm. This is the longest chapter in the whole Bible. And it's an interesting chapter. If you notice, if you have your Bibles open, you will notice that at the beginning that it is broken up into all eight verses per portion, and each portion has a word, a Hebrew word, up top, and those are the Hebrew alphabet. So this one is Tet. Now, there's not much known why David would have done this, but it is interesting in that he begins each one of these sections with that letter. So while our English alphabet has us with Y, that would be the Hebrew equivalent, Tet. But you might find that as we go into it, there are other words, like the next one, Yod, is actually also Y. So, like I said, our English alphabet is different from the Hebrew alphabet. So, let us read. You have dealt well with your servant, O Lord, according to your word. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe in your commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. You are good and do good. Teach me your statutes. The insolent smear me with lies, but with my whole heart, I keep your precepts. Your heart is unfeeling. Their heart is unfeeling like fat, but I delight in your law. It is good for me that I was afflicted, that I may learn your statutes. The law of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver pieces. So, main part of this portion of scripture is delighting in the Lord. Now, people are always looking for the meaning of life. They wonder what it is. They wonder what is the ultimate happiness that they can strive for. Man thinks it's winning the lottery or making deals with maybe shady people. The movies delve into this. They look into people searching for the meaning of true happiness. And those endings give sometimes anything but a happy ending. For many years, the church has always said, it's in the Bible. You've got to look in the Bible. And people say, well, I've looked in the Bible. I've looked, but I haven't seen it. Not realizing that the happiness is delighting in the Lord. It's the study of the scripture. It's understanding what God has done for us. Now, this is written by David, a man after God's own heart. He went through a whole bunch of things in his life. I mean, people have said that David's life would make a good Hollywood series or movie star. And they've tried to Hollywoodize it, make it more superficial than it is, but in truth, David's life is that Hollywood blockbuster type of movie because of everything he did, the fact that he was just a teenager when he was anointed king of Israel, and then he still has to strive for years before he gets a crown on his head, and then all the suffering that goes through in his life, with his family, with his friends, with the wars and everything, up until he gives the crown to his son Solomon. There's all this stuff that happens, and meanwhile, all through it all, we read in the Psalms, this man that truly loved God, that God called a man after his own heart. So, how do we learn to delight in the Lord? First thing is, we must always be hungry to learn. You'll notice, David points out twice, teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe in your commandments. And then in 68, he says, you are good and do good. Teach me your statutes. It is good for me that I was afflicted, that I may learn your statutes. So we go in and we see, you know, he wants to learn good judgment, knowledge, statutes. Those precepts, those are like the Ten Commandments and the laws of God. He wants to learn these. He wants good judgment. One thing that they say is successful people constantly learn. They'll watch videos, read books, go to conferences, but they continuously learn what it is in their job so that way there they can become better at it. The TED Talks are one of the things that has taken off over the last decade as people in business watch these things and they learn and they get an idea of how they can do that. And that's one thing. Pastors are told to continuously learn. We're told to continuously read books. If we can afford it, go back to school, take a couple of courses. Just continue to learn what it is because of the challenges we face in ministry. And David, he's seeking to learn to have the following good judgment. We are always looking to have this one trait. Being a judge of good character is a good thing. It helps us understand what's going on. If we can judge a person's character, we can stop the heartbreak, we can stop the betrayal, we can stop certain things that happen in our lives or in the lives of our friends by being able to judge that one person and say, you know, I don't know if they're 100% what they're portraying. It's also a good thing, like if you're struggling, you don't know if you should stay at a job, if you know, maybe there's something better out there. But having good judgment, being able to weigh those things. I've worked with a few people over the last year that have left my position, my job, where I'm at, and a couple have come back because the grass wasn't greener where they saw it. They weren't able to really get the full picture. They didn't have good judgment in that. And it's something that David points out we can achieve through reading and study of the Bible. Knowledge. This isn't an understanding of all things, but this is the knowledge of who God is, what God's will in our life is, what God is trying to create us to be, what He's created us to be, what His will is in our lives. We can argue that the Bible does shed light on mysteries that the world has yet to accept. But when it comes to God, this is where we understand that we can only get so much of an understanding of God here on earth, but we're not going to understand that fully until we get to heaven. But the knowledge that God gives us, the spiritual wisdom that He gives us, helps us to understand and helps us to give that good judgment back to people when they're trying to find good judgment. And then God's statutes. These are the laws, the rules of God. When we read about the Ten Commandments, those are what they say are the solid laws that many societies that have followed the Ten Commandments and basically turned it into something their own. But one thing that historians tell us is that at the heart of certain different societies, there is these ten rules in the Bible that they follow to a certain degree. So that we know that these are and what we should follow. Not just the Ten Commandments, but everything that Jesus tells us in the New Testament. Everything that is in here that is meant to help us and guide us. Now, the second point follows that. It's keeping God's laws. We see this here in 67 and 69. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. And then the insolent sneer me with lies, but with my whole heart I keep your precepts. So we see there, word, precepts. So David is trying to keep what he had back then, which was Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, some of the prophets. He's trying to follow those. He's trying to learn those. And even though he's a man, even though he falls short of being, having that 100% victory, he still strives for it. He still wants to know about it. He hungers for this knowledge of God. Now, we have to remember that we are born citizens of the country that we're in. And there's been a lot of that in the news lately. I'm not here to talk about that, but as citizens, we are told to follow the laws of our country, of our state, of our town. The same thing happens when we become Christians, when we are reborn, born again. We become citizens of heaven. And this is what Paul tells us. He says, but our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. And then in Ephesians, he wrote to the church there. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. So as citizens of heaven, as citizens of heaven and members of God's household, we need to learn the precepts. We need to learn what's going on. We need to study the Bible. We need to make this something. We have to have that desire to learn this. Now, there are many methods to trying to figure this out. Trying to study the Bible. They can get daunting. They can get so meticulous. In fact, the Methodists, the reason why they have that name is because they had a method to doing everything. So that's where they got their name. John Wesley had designed a way for them to study the Bible, and they called them the Methodists because of it. So there are many methods to this. I'm going to give you a simple one. The simple one is the SOAP method. Now each letter means something. So as you can see here, the S stands for Scripture. So you like physically write out the Scripture. Keep a journal. That's the best part. You keep a journal. You physically write the Scripture, and you'll be amazed at what God reveals through that Scripture. Just taking it, writing it down, repeating it slowly. One thing that they tell us is people learn best when you have to write something down. So as you write this down, you learn. You sit there and you go, oh, yeah, that's it. The next one is O. This stands for observation. You ask yourself, what are you reading? Who is the audience? Is there a repetition of words? Now, if we go back to what we just read in Psalm 119, we see repetition of precepts, statutes, word. We see those repetitions. So what is that trying to tell us? What words stand out to us? Next one is A, which is for application. So this is where we come and we realize that there's something personal to the word. What is God saying to me today? How can I apply this to my life? And what changes do I need to make in order to get there? And is there an action that I need to take now? And finally, the P is for prayer. So what you do is you sit there and you pray over this scripture. Maybe you pray a scripture. You understand that God is trying to tell you something, and you want to learn how this applies, how you can put it into application. You pray to God to give you those chances to apply it. You need to maybe confess something too. If God's revealed something, maybe a sin that scripture has taught us, you pray that up. This is what David's getting at. This is how David is. David mourns. Like when the whole thing with Bathsheba happened and Nathan pointed it out, what did he do? He cried out to God. And then we read in Psalm 51, this beautiful prayer of asking for forgiveness to God. And this is what happens. So we get this idea of what God is trying to tell us. So this is just one symptom. Now, studying God's Word like this can take a little time, and it can take a long time. It depends on how involved you want to be. It can take 5, 10 minutes. It can take an hour or more. But people develop all sorts of ways of how they study the Bible. There are people I know, when they study the Bible, they basically pull out a pencil box, and they have multiple colored pens and different things, and they just sit there and they have each color means something. And green for growth, red for love. You know, they just develop a code so then when they open the Bible up, they can sit there and they can look at it and be like, oh yeah, well, wait a minute, that's yellow. What does yellow mean? Oh yeah. They get the understanding of what Scripture is, and that's how God develops us, that's how God builds us up. And then it shows us also that we need to, as we develop this, it shows us that we need to then go home and study and do devotions with our family, with our spouses and kids. The third part that David talks about in delight is natural delight. Now we know that anything that is natural is better for us. You know, we have organic has become the big thing, you know. Organic peanut butter, which I've tried and I don't like. But organic meat is good. I've had chicken off the farm, no additives, no nothing, and I can tell you it tastes better. Eggs taste better than what you buy in the store. Those are good. Organic is something that for the last few decades it's become this popular thing. And so having this natural delight is a good thing. What is this? Well, you look at what David's saying here. He says, their heart is unfeeling like fat, but I delight in your law. The law of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver pieces. Now, Jesus told us in parables that God was better than anything on earth. Heaven's riches were so much that he tells the story of a person that buys a plot of land because he found what was there. And people think, you know, he's probably spent more money on the plot of land than what was there in the riches. But that's what God tells us, that he is worth more than anything on heaven, you know, anything here on earth. Many have taken vows of poverty. There are people, whether they've been Catholic or Orthodox or Protestant, they take a vow of poverty to serve God because they know that by spending their own money on God's mission, they're doing more than what could possibly ever be done. They dedicate their resources to sharing the gospel with people here in America and in other countries. In fact, some missionaries, history will tell us, there are some missionaries that were born into affluent families, rich families, We're talking New York socialites. They gave up their riches. And where they moved to, they lived in mud huts for 20, 30, 40, and even 50 years because they knew that Jesus was worth more. And they looked forward to not living in a mansion on earth, but a mansion in heaven. David sees God as a value worthy of his full devotion. God's price for us was Jesus. Isn't that notice enough for us to follow him and have that same devotion? You know, there is a story, usually around Christmas time, we always hear it. It's by O. Henry, The Gift of the Magi. And it talks about this couple, this young married couple that's so devoted to one another, so madly in love with each other, that they take the one thing that's precious to them, because they're poor, they don't have much. But they take the one thing that's precious to them. The wife, she sells her hair so she can buy this gold chain for her husband's watch. What does the husband do? The husband sells his watch so he can buy silver combs for his wife's hair. And the story goes on that they both treasure those gifts, even though they don't have what they were meant to be bought for. But they understand that love and devotion that their spouse gave them. That's the same thing God has done for us. When he gave Jesus here as payment for our sins, he showed that he loved us so much. Jesus showed that he wanted us to be with him and the Father so much. He gave up his life. He gave up everything. The Bible tells us that he was poured out like a drink offering. In other words, he had been in that spiritual realm with God. He became flesh and blood. And when he did, he learned all about the sufferings. He saw, he felt everything that humans had to go through. And he did it because of his immense love for us. So isn't that enough for us to want to give him everything we have? God's value on us was that Jesus would come to earth and give up that part of himself, live with us here, so that we could come to salvation. He sacrificed the one thing he had, his life, for us. So as we want to study the Bible, we go through one thing that this is God's story for us. When we go into Genesis, we go all the way to the end of Revelation. This is God's story for us. This is God's love for us. This shows us that God knew everything that was going to happen, and he already planned out what he was going to do to get us there with him. That alone should make you crave. That alone should make you want to hunger and study and get into the Bible more. So today, you know, go to the dollar store. Go to Dollar Tree. They got composition notebooks for a buck. They're really good, really sturdy. I'll admit that's what I do for my study. I could have a nice journal, but I keep these notebooks around, and when I study, that's what I use. Because my money is going to go elsewhere. You know, I've been hoping here over the last year. This is what we do to get closer to God. We study the Word. You know, this isn't my normal Bible. If I were to show you my normal Bible, it's that color-coded one. But that's what God wants. He wants us to be fully devoted to him. He wants us to love him. He wants us to understand that sacrificing for him is worth more than anything we can do here on earth. So we're going to go to the wedding prayer, and we're going to take our offering. I want you to take a few minutes just to think, you know, what do I need to do today to plug in more with God? What do I need to do? Maybe there's something. I know a friend who recently got rid of his TV because he realized he spent so much time watching TV, he wasn't getting into the Bible enough. Now, he'll message me. I'll be at work, and he'll message me, did you know this was in the Bible? Did you understand? And it's like, yeah, Jim, I know that. I know that's there. But he's delighting in the Lord, and he's realizing that he let certain things here take his eyes off of God. He let certain things take his eyes off where he was going. And as he's been focusing on this, and as he's been studying, there's a lot of things that now he realizes God has wanted him to do for a while, and so that's what he's beginning. He's beginning this journey, this whole journey to where God's will is in his life. What can your journey be? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for just who you are, and what you did. We can never understand fully the complexity of your majesty, but yet we know that you are mighty and powerful. You sent your Son here on earth. You sacrificed him for our sakes. And then you raised him back to life to prove that you had that power. Father, we just thank you for that. We just ask you to go with us as we leave today, as we go to our homes, as we go back to our lives. Father, just help us to keep our eyes focused on you. I pray for hunger for all of us, Father, to just get into the Word, have a seven-course meal of Scripture, and just tear it apart. Father, we just ask that you would be with us, give us a good week, bring us back safely next week, and help us, Father, to be a light for you in this community. We ask this all, Father, and we just pray now for the offering that you would bless it. Use it for your ministry here. We just ask that you would just be with the gift and the giver. We ask this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen.